this morning. So I shared, I think it was last Sunday, and I know I shared again on Wednesday, that I really feel like the Lord is saying that 2017 is going to be a year of reaping and harvesting, and that all of the resistance from that we felt in the enemy and all the attacks of the enemy from 2016 are ending in Jesus' name. And it was the 8th that I saw on Facebook that someone from the Elijah List had posted a prophetic word called Releasing the Angels of Abundant Harvest. So I thought I'd share. This is from Jennifer LeClaire from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. An abundant harvest is at hand. I'm releasing angels of abundant harvest into the nation. You will reap what you have sown, and this is a double-edged sword. Where the enemy has resisted your harvest in your past, in years past, you will see a multiplication effect of blessings on your life. Doors will open unto you that no man can open. Opportunities will come your way that you never dreamed, imagined, or even thought to ask for. Provision will enter your life from unexpected places. If you have sown to the Spirit, you will reap from the Spirit. If you have sown into my kingdom business, you will see a return on the investment of your time, your finances, and your relationships. Reinforcement will come to support the work of your hand, and you will find that lack is no longer in your language. You will see blessings chase you down and overtake you. You will find that I am leading you and guiding you with greater precision. You will hear my voice and dream my dreams and see my visions. You will rest in me and have confidence and faith in me that defies the enemy's plans for your life. This is a year of abundant harvest. I am releasing the angels of abundant harvest. They will minister blessings to the heirs of salvation. They will bring provision and protection from the enemy's sword. I am releasing the angels of abundant harvest, and make your choice. Choose this day whom you will serve with your whole heart. I am a God of justice, and I am also a God of mercy. And, you know, there have been so many attacks and so many struggles and so many issues that we have dealt with in 2016. And I believe that the enemy knows that there's breakthrough coming. And this morning, as I was praying for Des Moines and praying for our body and praying for this time, I was led to Joshua chapter 24. And this is where the Lord is reminding all of Israel of how far he's taken them. Joshua chapter 24, verse 11. And you went over Jordan and came into Jericho, and the men of Jericho fought against you, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Girgashites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and I delivered them into your hand. And I sent the hornet before you, which drove them out from before you, even the two kings of the Amorites, but not with thy sword, nor with thy bow. And I have given you a land for which you did not labor, and cities which you did not build, and ye dwell in them, of the vineyards and olive yards which ye planted not, do you eat. And I believe that that is where we are. And I've been praying about these principalities and powers over the city, and I realized this morning the Lord told me that that's these two Amorite kings that are getting ready to be kicked out of this city. Our city is named the Two Rivers, and there's two principalities and powers that have had authority in this area for much too long, and their days are numbered. And in 2017 is the time for this city to come alive in the Lord, in the Spirit of the Lord, when the blessings and the harvest come to Des Moines, Iowa, I really believe. And I know that Sally last Sunday said that when we pray for our body, when we pray for each other, pray against the spirit of infirmity. And I also think we need to pray against the spirit of religion and the spirit of witchcraft. There are so many attacks that are unnecessary and are going to stop.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And so if there has been an attack on your family, if you have been struggling with things, if you have promises that the Lord has planted in your heart that you have been waiting and praying and waiting to see come to pass, the dark night is ending. And Tammy shared that after the night comes the day. And the sun is rising and the blessings are coming and our Lord is making the way. If we will hold on and if we will believe and if we will praise him while we wait, and if we will worship him and we will wait in expectant hope, our faith will have substance in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
So with that, anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies they'd like to share this morning? Yeah.
I'll just share. she lost over 50 pounds in this time, and they finally checked her in on Monday night at the hospital. She's been there. She got checked out yesterday, but they ended up removing her gallbladder. So they're hoping that's is the problem to everything she's been going through. But in that time, I was able to witness to her. She still attends a church. They're God, Jesus loving, but they don't know to speak against the enemy. You have a true enemy, Mom, that's attacking your body. You know, you gotta come at him with the word and stand on that. So the few days she was in there, I was able to just keep witnessing to her spirit. She knows, she believes. And then I was also able to pray for a stranger. She came into the waiting room while we were there, and I had been praying all morning that God, you know, we're not here to just live for us. We're here to live for you. Mm-hmm. To lay hands on people. There is a dying world. We all know it. Mm-hmm. But I was just praying that morning before I left. Lord, send somebody in front of me that I can pray for, speak your word to. Well, sure enough, he sent. Her name was Drea, and she was just diagnosed with 4-stage lung cancer. And she said the last time they went and checked on it, it was 3-stage. And she then said, thank you, God. Like, she was, you know, God-fearing woman. So I had just asked her, you know, the boldness doesn't come from my flesh. It came from God. And immediately he was just like, lay hands on her. And so we did and spoke God's truth. And afterwards, she kind of stepped back and looked at me. And she's like, what religion are you? And then I just have a relationship. She goes, well, she was in the Air Force for 15 years, and she said that she studied religion. And she goes, and the way you pray was just, yeah, I can tell you're a Christian. So anyway, I just keep Drea in your prayers. God knows her, knows her need, and just continued recovery from my mom.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
And that reminds me, I forgot to say the most important thing. The Amorite kings, the Amorite means a sayer. It means a speaker. A boaster. The enemy that we are fighting is a boaster and a speaker. We need to use our words to overcome this enemy. We need to not speak his words.
Right.
We need to not speak the complaints and the actuality of our circumstances, but we need to speak the truth.
Right.
That's how the enemy is defeated.
That's
when we refuse to give in to say what he says,
right.
When we speak the truth in love.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. Sally.
Yes,
they do. Something that my husband has been trying to help me with because I want to talk things through and over and over and chew and chew and chew until there's nothing left but dust. And he looks at me and he says, Suzanne, let it go.
Yeah.
Let it go. And I'll never forget, we had a women's Bible study, and the Lord just showed me that our worries should be like hot potatoes. We don't want to hold on to them. We don't want to, they burn us. They hurt us.
Right.
Get rid of them like hot potatoes. Toss them, pass them, and just throw them right back at the enemy, because that's where they came from to begin with. To get us to turn our eyes from our hope and the person, the answer, you know? And if we can just let it go.
Right, that's good.
Let it go.
Take your burdens to the Lord.
Yes.
Leave them there.
Yes. Cast all your cares upon him.
Yes.
It's his pleasure.
Yes.
It is his pleasure when we will trust him enough to let it go. Right? Amen. Amen. That's right. Yeah. Tim.
Yes, I just want to praise the Lord. We've been out of town visiting the family, and we got to, spend time with them. It's always a precious time. You know, we don't get down there that often, especially in Missouri. But to be able to pray with them, you know, that is just such an awesome thing. And then find out we're having another grandbaby in June.
Come on,
so
come
that's
on.
Always
Lord.
That's always precious for that.
Yes.
And
yes.
I just appreciate, like, Friday night, I do the night drive. I never take them lightly because, you know, we're running out on the road. And so we had a truck there, and we've been using that truck all week. But we had a little problem with it getting off the yard, you know. And then I got behind the wheel, and we still had a problem with it. I said, if it does it one more time, we're done. You know, we're just going to grab another truck. And it turned out we had a problem with it. But I was so thankful that people were praying because, you know, in a few minutes we've been off the yard, and we might have got broke down. So I was really thankful that happened. God was watching over us that happened at that point. Because we didn't have any trouble the rest of the night with the other truck. But that's God protecting you. Sometimes it looks like something's bad is going on.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of times those things, I said, God, you're still in control.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you knew this truck was going to act up at the time. We've been using it all week. Never had a problem until that night when we was going to go out of town.
Mm-hmm.
And I just felt, I said, praise God, because I knew it was him. When we got back on the yard and everything was fine, and I just thank God for how he brings people into their lives. It may be a new employee, but it's great when that new employee is a believer, and you have that kindred spirit, and you can share back and forth prayer requests and praises what
yes.
God has done. And I thank the Lord. I just I've just been so thankful this week.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise
God.
Lord God.
Yeah. What was that song we sang Friday night? Leave it there?
Yeah.
Leave it there. Take it to the Lord and leave it there.
Mm-hmm.
Put our hope
Amen.
And our trust in him. Yeah. Amen. Anybody else have anything, any prayer requests, any testimonies this morning? All right, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you that you set the perfect example. You came, humbled yourself, became a man, born as a virgin, and walked among us to show us the way, Lord, to teach us the way of the abundant life, Lord. That when we look to you, when we speak your words, Lord, when we follow your leading and your guiding, Lord, all things are possible. All things are possible if we will hope and trust in you, if we will speak words of life, speak words of truth, that we will see life, that we will see joy. We will have peace in our hearts and peace all around us, Lord. Oh, I thank you, Lord, for your example, Lord. And I thank you that when we can come to you, we cast our cares, Lord. We lay our burdens down. And we put our hope and our trust in you, knowing that you are faithful, that you never leave us, you never forsake us, Lord. We thank you that this season is ending, Lord, and the new season is coming, Lord. That we listen for your voice, Lord. We listen for the leading of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Continue your work in this body, Lord. Continue your work in this city, Lord. Continue your work in this nation, Lord. You are our King, Lord. You are in charge, Lord. You have a purpose and a plan for this nation, for the United States of America. You have a purpose and a plan for Des Moines, Iowa. You have a purpose and a plan for every member of this body, Lord. Continue to pour out your wisdom and revelation. Open the hidden mysteries of your word that have been saved for this time, for this hour. Continue to bless our pastor, Lord, with abundance, Lord, with protection, Lord. Jesus. Continue to search this city, Lord, for those who are hungry, those who are hurting, Lord, those who need to know you, those who need a place, a safe place to come and worship and receive your word. And let your church be bold. Be bold in sharing the hope and the love that you have placed in us, Lord. Oh, that your grace, oh, your grace and your goodness. Everybody needs to know of your grace, your love, your mercy. Oh, Jesus. Be with us this morning, Lord. Have your way in this service, Lord, as we come together to speak your word, to worship you, and to receive your word. Let our minds be renewed today by the receiving and the hearing of your word. And let us go forth in boldness, led by your Spirit, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just a reminder, if you have a cell phone with you today, to please turn the ringer off or to go ahead and turn your cell phone off. And let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Yes, Lord. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord. Let's see, Toby and Eric, do you two want to take the offering this morning? Let's put it out. Toby, you want to ask the blessing, please?
Lord, we're thankful to be here today, God. Be with your people.
Thank you,
declare your word is truth, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
God, in the upcoming weeks as we head into the new year, let this word spoken here today go forth, God. That this will be 2017,
yes.
Your year, God.
Yes,
the great
Lord.
Harvest, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
And the pieces will begin to come together,
yes,
God, in your great plan. The years that we have heard, Lord God, Jesus, now come together and unfold, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We follow your truth, God,
yes,
through you have spoken it, and we declare it.
Yes.
Now, Lord, we just ask that you'll bless this offering day. Bless the gift and the giver in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord.
I
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let's just love the Lord right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, for your unfailing love and kindness, for your grace, Lord, that is exceeding abundantly above even what we think we need. Lord, we thank you for every good and precious gift that comes from you and you alone, Lord, the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. Thank you, Lord, that even though it seems like we are in darkness at times, your light shines brighter and brighter in all of our lives by the power of your Spirit and the goodness and faithfulness of your love. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Sunday school kids can be dismissed. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening. Thank you for sharing. All of you that have shared, appreciate it so much. Sharing even your prayer requests, that we can have the privilege of taking those before the throne. Amen. And we know that if our requests are in the will of God, and every one that we heard certainly is, then we know that he hears us. And if he hears us, he said, we know that we have our petition. Praise God. So just write it down. Your prayer was answered today. Yes. Praise the Lord. Amen. So thank the Lord for each and every one of you. Thank you for praying for us. Praise the Lord. We had quite an adventure getting here this morning. But here we are. Praise the Lord. So that's all that really matters. Hallelujah. And I'm so grateful to everybody that shared this morning, because it's always great. You feel like you, and in fact, you use the word of God, it's anointed in and of itself. But it's always great to have the confirmations that come from the testimonies. And because, you know, we're all one spirit. So when we share, we know that that same spirit in us is, you know, identifying with one another. Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, the scripture says a matter is established. And so certainly we have that reality here this morning. And so I hope you remember the things that were said by the different speakers this morning that shared their testimonies and what God is doing in their life and how they feel that God is encouraging them to speak and to deal with the situations and circumstances of their life. Because we all are the same. I mean, we all have issues. We all have family. We all have concerns. We all have health and financial things that go up and down all the time. And the enemy would love to keep us freaked out and paranoid and afraid of what the future holds. But we know it's God that holds our future. Amen.
Yes.
So praise the Lord. That's what I want to talk to you about this morning. And if you would, Mike, let's start with Psalms 103, verses 2 through 7. I've got several scriptures here I want to use to just kind of establish the context from where we're going this morning. But here the psalmist says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfieth thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like eagles. Praise the Lord. The Lord executeth righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of God. And that's critical here, that he made known his ways to Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. It's easy for us sometimes to get hung up in the acts and miss the ways, because it's the ways that dictate the acts. If we understand the ways of God, we can be confident in the acts of God. Amen. So moving on, let's go to Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 2. Isaiah 43 and 2. When thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee. Through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. Praise the Lord. We need to embrace these scriptures. This is the word of God. It's the truth of God. Yes. It's not just semantics. It's just not just verbiage. It's God revealing himself in his word. Amen. Psalms 103, verse verses 2, I think we already did that, didn't we? Psalms 130 and 5. Psalms 130, verse 5. I wait for the Lord, my soul doth wait, and in his word do I hope.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
And the last one to open with here, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved for you in the Spirit, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. How many of you know this is the last time? Praise God.
Yeah.
He's ready to be revealed in us.
Yeah.
Amen. Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations.
Yeah.
Praise God. Verse 7. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than the gold that perisheth,
yes,
though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Now, if you can, Mike, just drop down to verse 13. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, we've talked about staying focused on him. Revelation only comes that way.
Yes.
You'll never get past your own intellect and your own fears and anxiety without a revelation. And that revelation comes solely by staying focused on Jesus. Because that's why the enemy wants you hung up in all the stuff.
Yeah.
Because it stops revelation.
Yeah.
It keeps you focused on you and your problem and your issue, mm-hmm, rather than focusing on Jesus, who is the answer.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. Somebody once said that the character of a life is not set in two or three dramatic moments, but in the 10,000 little moments.
Yes.
The longer you live, the more you realize that. You may have had some, you know, major situations in your life at some point where you felt a great victory and everything was going great. I've learned over the years that it's the little things every day that make us who we are. And so this is the battle that we're in. We're in the battle of the minute to minute, moment to moment, day to day, month to month, year to year. Praise the Lord. The trials that we go through in life can be devastating. There's no question about it. We've all had them. If you haven't, hang on. Praise the Lord. They can put you in a place of real confusion, and they can do it in a hurry. When you lose hope, you start thinking wrong thoughts about God. And that leads to a wrong perspective on what he's going to do and what he is doing in your life. It goes all the way back to the garden. First thing the enemy tried to do was get Adam and Eve to think bad thoughts about God, to think that God was somehow keeping something from him, that he wasn't going to do everything in his power, which is all power. To provide, to bless, to keep, and so on and so forth. And the enemy, his tactics haven't changed because he knows they work. He just keeps playing the same game over and over and over. It's like they say, I know I hear it in politics all the time, but if you tell a lie often enough, eventually people begin to believe that it's the truth.
Yeah.
You just keep repeating it, and that's what the enemy does all the time.
Yeah.
Exodus chapter 15, verse 21. And I do believe that we're coming on a new season, call it what you want, a breakthrough, in the new year, what God wants to do. But listen, a lot of this is dependent on us. As Suzanne said this morning, God's done everything he's going to do. It is finished as far as God's concerned. It's a question of whether or not we're going to walk in that, believe it, testify to it, speak it out, and live it out in our lives. That's the only real question here. The equation has to be completed. Amen. And we're the ones that finish it. Praise the Lord. In this world, he said it's finished, but until his enemies have made his footstool, that's our job. We're to continue to enforce the victory that Jesus has already won. Praise the Lord. So Miriam answered them saying, now this is, just to give you some context here, you most of you probably already know, but they'd just been delivered out of slavery in Egypt. They had been released, everybody's healthy, everybody's whole, everybody got plenty of money in their pocket. You know, the Egyptians were giving them stuff just to get you out of here, you know, just take it and go. They get to the Red Sea, and here comes the Pharaoh's army, and they're freaking out, and God just opens up the Red Sea, and they walk through on dry ground. They're on the other side. The enemy has been swallowed up by the sea, and they've been delivered. And so Miriam, Moses' sister, answered them, sing ye to the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. So they're having a great celebration. It's party time, you know, on the opposite shore. And they're just having a great time, and they're celebrating everything that God has done. Israel exploded into praise because of God's faithfulness, because of his powerful deliverance, because he showed himself mighty on their behalf, and they were excited. Praise the Lord. But that show of God's goodness and power brought tremendous gratitude and thanksgiving. But the thrill of victory changed to the agony of defeat when food and water were scarce. And in no time, their singing changed to grumbling. Again, I'm saying, life isn't made up of a few major events in your life. Life is made up of the little things that happen all the time that we're challenged by, that we're constantly trying to get diverted away from the victory, from what God has done, and from what God is capable of doing, what God wants to do. Amen? So look at Exodus now, chapter 15, verses 22 through 24. Exodus 15, 22 through 24, just goes on. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur. They went 3 days in the wilderness, and they found no water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. Therefore the name of it was called Marah. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, what shall we drink? So just 3 days away from this major deliverance, from this huge victory, and they're grumbling. Why? Because they forgot the Lord's goodness. That quickly, it can happen.
Yeah.
You can have a breakthrough, you can have a major thing happen, and just, I mean, in a matter of days, you can be under fear again. You can be back in a place of doubt and of questioning whether God's going to come through for you. Is God going to do it? I mean, sometimes we don't even realize we're in the battle until the battle's half over.
Right.
And then we go, oh, whoa, this was a spiritual thing.
Right.
Amen?
Amen?
Exodus chapter 16. Verses 2 and 3. Exodus 16, verses 2 and 3.
And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full. For ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill us, to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Amen. Then Exodus chapter 17, verse 2. And I just remind you, all of this stuff is in there for us.
Yeah.
It's not a history book. It's not so that we can look back and say, gee, look what a mess they were. These are all types and shadows. These are all examples. Because God knows we're all going to be facing situations and circumstances that are similar to theirs. Amen? Temptation is the same. The temptation itself may be different, but the purpose of the temptation is always the same. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide you with me? Wherefore do you tempt the Lord? So look at the context here. God brought them out of slavery in Egypt. He saved them from Pharaoh's army, gave them water, gave them manna every day. And their response? Complaining, grumbling, whining, and doubting. Instead of praising God for his mighty acts and trusting him to help again, they accuse him. It's like they're showing what's in their heart. God does like this heart MRI, and he can look right in there and see what this is about. Amen?
Amen.
Instead of praising God, they're accusing. So you might ask, well, Nathan, why are we looking at this issue of complaining in such a detail? And here's the answer. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 9 through 13.
Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of serpents. Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. Now all these things happened unto them for examples. And they're written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it. Praise the Lord. The people assumed the worst, that God's not going to help. God's not going to intervene. God's angry at me. God doesn't like me. God has an issue with me for some reason. They denied God's protection, and they denied God's provision. And it's already been said today, this is about a work that's finished. Christ in you, yes. The hope of glory has, yes, to be our focus.
Yes.
Everything that we have need of, we already have, yes, in us, in Christ.
Yes.
It's not like we're begging God to give us something that he hasn't already given. It's a question of whether or not we can believe,
right,
for the manifestation of that reality,
right,
for that truth to become fact.
Amen.
Or I should say, maybe that fact to become truth. You got to watch your mind and pay attention to your thoughts.
Yes.
Because those thoughts can get away from you quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll become irrational in the way that you think.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about anybody else, but I get woke up in the middle of the night all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's usually the first thing I feel is fear,
mm-hmm,
or anxiety.
Yeah.
Because I'm not thinking conscious thoughts. It's just you get flooded with possibilities that could happen, things that might take place, what the future holds, and all that kind of stuff. That's the enemy.
Yes.
I've learned, I just start praying in tongues.
Yep.
It works.
Yep.
It takes your mind. You can't be focused on two or three different things. I just start praying in tongues, and it isn't long before I'm able to go back to sleep. And you say, well, you haven't accomplished anything. I don't know what I've accomplished.
Yeah.
I know what God is accomplishing as I release my faith.
Right.
And pray the prayer of faith.
Come on.
That's a prayer of the Spirit that is not messed up with my anxieties and my thoughts and my doubts and my fears. It's just a releasing of what God wants to do. I don't really have to know what he's going to do or how he's going to do it. I just have to trust that he's in charge.
Right.
He's got the whole thing taken care of. Praise the Lord. So when your mouth, what happens is you start thinking irrational thoughts, and how many of you know you can't say anything without thinking it first?
Right.
You start thinking irrational thoughts, and then your mouth starts running,
right,
and you start saying things that are contrary to the Word of God.
That's right.
That contradict God, that contradict what God promises you.
Yes.
I'm not picking on people. I'm saying we all deal with this. These are temptations that are common to man. Now, the particular issue might be different for you than it is for me, but the temptation is the same.
Right.
The temptation is to get me to doubt God. The temptation,
right,
is to get me to start focusing on me,
right,
and why I'm not getting and accomplishing what it is I think I should be accomplishing,
yes,
when I should just be focused on God, because he's,
yes,
the author and finisher of my faith.
Lord.
He's the only one that can do what I need,
yes,
to have done in my life anyhow.
Yes.
Lord.
Praise the Lord. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Keep your heart with all diligence, because out of it are the issues of life.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is not talking about the heart pump here or the blood pump. He's talking about the spirit. We have to keep our spirit in line with God. We have to keep this focus on Christ in us, the hope of glory. We have to keep the focus, amen, that this is about what God is going to do. Because out of this, out of my spirit, flow the issues of my life or the realities of my life. It's easy to say you get what you say. We get what we say because what we say we have to have already been thinking.
Right.
Amen.
Or we wouldn't have said it.
Right.
And our thoughts betray our heart.
Yes.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. That's why we have to be disciplined. That's why we have to have our mind renewed. And that's why we have to put a watch over this tongue, because this thing can, he said, it's like the most powerful thing that there is. It's like a rudder on a huge ship. This one little thing can turn a gigantic multi-ton thing through the water.
Right.
Guard your tongue.
Right. Right.
Be careful what you say.
Yes. Right.
Amen.
Because we get most of what we end up saying. And a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Don't think that you can get anything from God.
Right.
Because you're fluctuating all the time whether you believe or you're in unbelief.
Right. Right.
It isn't so much what you're thinking, it's what you're allowing your thoughts to get out of your mouth.
Right.
Yes. Thinking of a negative doesn't make it a reality. It's
right.
When we start talking it.
Right. Right.
Amen?
Right.
The thoughts come and they go. They're like the birds, you know. They fly over us, they do this all the time. The enemy's constantly planting seeds of doubt.
Yes.
But what grows is what we speak.
Yes.
Right. Yes.
Amen. Isn't that what the Lord said? The words are like seeds.
Yes.
They create a harvest.
Yes.
Good or bad.
Right.
And I know some of this stuff is like ancient history, but look, sometimes we just got to be reminded. It may be ancient history, but it's still the Word of God. It's still what we've got to be doing, and we can get sidetracked thinking it's about this thing or it's about that thing. It's about everything. The thing that makes us like God is the ability to speak. Did you not know that? I mean, the thing that, not, it's not the only thing, but it's one of the things that makes us created in His image is we have the ability to say. Animals don't.
Right.
You know, I say it all the time. We got a couple of cats and a dog. Dumb as rocks, all three of them. And they'll be sitting there looking, and you think, wondering what they're thinking. They're not thinking anything. That's a dog. It's just looking, because it can see it. You know, it's like somebody said, does a tree make a noise when it falls in the woods? I don't know, and I don't care.
Yeah.
Can a blind man see red? I mean, does it make any difference to him whether it's red or green?
Right.
It's irrelevant. Praise the Lord. Amen. Sounds like a really deep thought, but it's really quite stupid if you think about it. I mean, what difference does it make? If there's nobody there to hear it, what difference does it make if there's a sound?
Yeah.
If you can't see color, what difference does it make what colors are? You know?
Right.
It becomes irrelevant pretty quick.
Right.
If we don't think the way God thinks, we're like listening for trees falling somewhere that we can't hear them. We're like looking for colors that we can't see. We're creating impossibilities for ourselves.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. So, out of the heart are the issues of life. Now look what God said about that time in Israel's history that we spoke of earlier. Psalms 95, verse 10. And this isn't an attack on anybody or any of you. As I said, we're all going through this. This is a reminder. This is to get us. Sometimes you got to reset. Sometimes you just got to go back to the beginning, amen, and just remind yourself, this is the way it works, amen. 40 years long was I grieved with this generation and said, it is a people that do err in their heart and they have not known my ways. Now, they knew the acts of God because they saw them.
Right.
He gave them manna. He gave them water in the wilderness. He delivered them from Pharaoh. Over and over and over, they saw the acts of God, and yet God says, but the reason I'm grieved with them, the reason my heart breaks for them, is because they don't know my ways.
Right.
We can know the acts of God. We can have God move in our lives and have a miracle here and a miracle there, and we go, oh, I've seen the manifestation of God here, and that's an act of God, but do we know the ways of God? Because if you know the ways of God, you'll never be concerned about the next act of God.
Yes.
His ways are always the same, to bless.
Yes.
To prosper,
yes.
To encourage, to love, to save, to provide. That's the way of God. That's the ways of God.
Yes, Lord.
So we can know acts without knowing ways. And the not knowing the ways messes up the acts.
Come on.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Israel had all of these facts about the goodness of God. They received His grace. They received His provision. They knew all of that. But in Psalm 95, God says they didn't know His ways. Now, some of you know I'm a big, I wouldn't say fan, but I really get absorbed in Civil War history and that whole time. I love Mark Twain. He grew up in that time and wrote during that time. I've got several biographies of Abraham Lincoln, other Civil War generals, both North and South. It's just a fascinating time to me. In a way, you know, you think, well, I'd like to live there. Well, I wouldn't want to live there. I wouldn't want to go back to that time. No antibiotics, you know, not very good medicine. Everything was kind of messed up. But the innocence of it, the thought that there was an opportunity there to create a new nation, you know, a different kind of way of living and so forth is exciting to me. But Here's a quote from Abraham Lincoln. He said, "At what point is the approach of danger to be expected?" And he answers himself, "If it ever reach us, it must spring up among us. It cannot come from abroad. If destruction be our lot, we must ourselves be its author and finisher. As a nation of free men, we must live through all time or die by suicide. As it happened to Israel, so it has happened to us." Does that make sense to anybody else? Because what he's saying is, we're our problem. God has provided. He's made us free men and women. We've been born again, born from above. So if destruction comes to us, it has to come from us. It can't come from outside. The enemy has no power over us, but what we yield or cede to him. It's a powerful statement that is based on the Word of God and everything that we're talking about this morning. The enemy cannot do anything to you that you don't allow him the access to do. He has no power over you, but what we cede to him. Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 20. Romans 1, 18 through 20. Because it's really time, you know, to kind of gut it out here, to tough it up, you know, to, I don't know how to say this, but it's time for us to grow up. You know, I hate the expression, but put on your big boy pants. But it's true in a way. It's time to just, you know, man up, woman up, and do what we have the power to do.
Yes.
And stop complaining and start doing.
Yes.
Start being. Amen? Yes. So, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Drop down to verse 25, Mike. Who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Now that is exactly what happens when we are under attack or going through a wilderness. We stop thanking God. We start thinking twisted thoughts.
Right.
Twisted attitudes. Mm. And we become irrational.
Right.
We take our eyes off of God and focus on us, the creature, instead of the Creator. Our focus is on the immediate problem. And the problem grows and God shrinks. Focused on the creature. And when you focus on the creature, it becomes idolatry.
Yeah.
I know that's not a pleasant thought, but the truth is when we are so hung up on us and our issues, that's a form of idolatry. We don't have to bow down to us and say, oh, he's such a perfect person, or she's such a perfect person, or I'm wonderful. No. When my focus is all about me instead of God, that's idolatry. I'm making myself bigger than God. I'm making myself more important than God. I'm not scared. I'm saying we got grace. It's all good. But he's telling us this for a reason. Because when you're not operating in the mindset of God being first and God being all-powerful, the enemy has access to you, the creature. He has no access to the Creator, which lives in us, but he has access to the creature in whom he lives. And if we begin to make the focus about us, all of a sudden, the enemy has access.
Yep.
He has power. Back to my Civil War. I love this stuff. But Robert E. Lee was traveling through a southern state after the Civil War. And he stopped for water at this huge plantation. And he got off his horse, and the lady of the house came out to bring him some water, and immediately showed him this blackened tree stump in front of this beautiful home. And she began to tell Lee that the stump had been this beautiful, majestic oak tree until this northern shell hit it. He listened kindly, but the woman continued, railing on about the
greatness and the beauty and the majesty of this great oak tree that the Northern Army had destroyed. And her bitterness began to spill out over her grief for this stately tree that had been the centerpiece, the focal point of this plantation's entrance. When she stopped speaking long enough to take a breath, Lee looked at her and said, "My dear lady, cut it down and forget about it." It's the hot potato that Suzanne was talking about.
Yes.
Let it go. We obsess over things that are not worth obsessing about.
Right.
We need to just let it go.
Yes.
And trust God.
Absolutely.
Sometimes we don't like to hear the answer to our questions.
Yeah.
I get them all the time.
Right.
What do I do in this? What do I do about that? You tell them, and then they're not happy because it wasn't the answer that they wanted.
I can
promise you this woman wanted sympathy. She wanted a pat on the head. She wanted him to get into her pity party with her and to be all upset and to be sad and to be depressed. But he knew the only answer for her to move on was to cut the thing down and get on with life.
Yes.
That part of history is over, and it's time to move on. Let it go. Praise God.
Yes.
There's a difference between complaining about God and bringing concerns to God.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with that. That's what prayer is about.
Yes.
Right? He says, bring your burdens to the Lord. But as it has been wisely said here this morning, leave them there.
Yeah.
Don't take them and then bring them back with you so that you can complain about it for the next 6 months. Take them to the Lord and let it go.
Yes.
Give it to him.
Yeah.
Be done with it. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Philippians 4, 6 and 7. Because I want everything that God has promised for this upcoming year.
Yes.
And for the years to follow.
Yes.
But I also know that without some self-discipline, without some real sense of what God is trying to do in our lives, it ain't going to happen. I don't care how much it's promised.
Right.
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 I mean, it's the will of God that all be saved.
Right.
Amen.
But is everybody saved? No, because not everybody is responding to that free gift, that invitation. They're not stepping out in faith based on what God has already done.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's imperative. It's critical that we take our active part in what God prophesies through us.
Right.
It's not enough to say it. We have to believe it and then live it out. Walk in it. Amen? So be careful for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Don't be afraid. Just take it to God and leave it there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Yes.
Take it and dump it, cut it down, and leave it in his lap, and then walk away from it. Trust in his ways, and you'll see his acts come to pass in your life.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. A right perspective. You focus on Jesus. You focus on the Word of God. Philippians 1 and 6. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Being confident of this very thing. This is knowing his ways. Being confident of this very thing, that he that has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
That's knowing his ways.
Yes.
It's not a specific act. He's just saying, whatever the problem, you can have confidence that I'm going to get you through this. I got you into it. I'm going to get you out of it.
Amen.
You know, I've been with you from the moment you accepted me. Now, trust that I've begun a good work in you when you were born again. Trust that I can perform that good work in you until the day that Jesus comes, or till we are raptured out of here, or we go on to be with the Lord.
Come on.
That's knowing the ways of God.
Right.
That's not being dependent on a diagram or a blueprint on how he's going to act in this situation. It's just knowing that beyond any doubt, I know his ways. So his acts have to comply. They have to conform to his ways.
Right.
Which are to make sure that my days end good.
Right.
And that the days between his entering into my life and my leaving this life is going to be good. And it's going to be because of his ways that bring it to pass.
Amen.
Whatever you're going through, whatever pain you have, whatever difficulty, whatever hardship, whatever confusion, whatever fears, praise him. Praise him. It's hard.
But David said, I will praise the Lord in the middle of all kinds of chaos and what looked like his life was falling all apart. He said, I will. I'm going to make a conscious choice. Do I feel like it? No. Because there's too much evidence here to cause me to be fearful and frightened. But I'm going to make a choice. I will praise the Lord at all times.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That's what we need to do. We need to praise him because the Lord will accomplish what concerns you.
Yes.
He will for your life.
Glory.
God's ways cannot be thwarted in your life. He's greater. Amen. The devil is not in the details of our lives. God is in the details of our lives.
Yes.
Jesus himself is our provision. He's our Savior. He is the way of God. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now just to bring it into our personal realm here. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 18 to 20. Deuteronomy 17, verses 18 to 20. Now remember, everything in that Old Testament was written as examples. We've already read that. There are types and shadows. They're pointing us in the way that God wants us to go. They were natural things that took place that relate to spiritual truth, spiritual reality. All right? So this is talking to the king. They're speaking to the king here. And he says, it'll be when this king, when the king sits upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book out of that which is before the priests of the Levites. The law, the commandments of God, the word of God. Amen? And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all the words of this law and these statutes to do them. That his heart be not lifted up above his brethren, and that he turn not aside from the commandment to the right hand or to the left. So that he stays focused on what God is saying, not getting distracted by something that's happening over here, or something that's happening over here, amen, or to the left, to the end that he may prolong his days in his kingdom, that he and his children in the midst of Israel. And again, I'm reminding you, this is types and shadows. The law here, Jesus fulfilled. So our focus now is to stay focused on Jesus, the living word, the word of God.
Right.
Don't turn to the right. Don't let the enemy get you distracted over here over some situation that looks threatening. Don't let him get distracted by something that's happening over here. Stay focused on the Lord.
Yes.
That's how your life is going to be prolonged. That's how you're going to be blessed. That's how your children will be blessed.
Yes.
That's how things will work out for your good.
Yes.
Amen. And if you don't believe me, look at Revelation chapter 1 and verse 6.
Hath made us kings and priests unto his God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever.
Amen. That was written in Deuteronomy to us.
Yes.
Kingdom of kings and priests.
Yes.
You are kings and priests. And we've been challenged to keep the focus on the Lord, on the word of God, and not be distracted by the things that the enemy tries to bring up over here, or that he tries to bring up over here, that he tries to make look like it's going to overwhelm us. Stay focused, and your life will be prolonged.
Yes.
And the lives of your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, as many as you have, are going to be blessed as a result of it.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. And I know, you know, sometimes trouble comes in like a flash flood. Relationships fail. You know, scary diagnosis comes. You lose a job. And the response is generally, initially, fear.
Yeah.
Just like Jane was saying, it happens to all of us. If you've got kids or grandkids, you're going to hear stuff that just scares the crap out of you. You wonder, what do I do? How do I manage this?
Right.
Because that's human. Because we love them. Because we care for them. So let me close with this last scripture, Lamentations chapter 3, verse 21 through 26. Lamentations 3, 21 through 26. Sometimes they don't even have to come and say anything to us.
Right.
We just know the world that they're living in.
Yes.
We just know that it's not the world we grew up in.
Right.
We know that it's a whole different thing, and there's reason to be concerned because they don't have the support systems that we have
right.
as kids. The schools and everything are not Christian oriented.
Right.
So it causes us to fear. But God is still on the throne.
Yes, he is.
Whether he's in our schools or not, that's a pathetic testimony to the United States and to our government and to our allowing things like this to happen. But that's beside the point.
Right.
God is still on the throne.
Yes.
Yeah.
God can still, he still rules
yes.
with authority. Amen.
Yes.
So this I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed
yes.
because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore will I hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord.
Amen.
It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. If we know his ways, we can hope and patiently wait for the act to come that coincides with his ways. He is God. He knows how desperate you are for help. Consider the work of God. Consider his ways, and you'll know that help is on the way.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand
yes.
this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. We stay in this mindset and continuously remind ourselves of the ways of God. And I promise you, this new year will be great, will be the best year of your life. It has to be because God's already been there. He's already laid everything out. If we can believe it, if we can trust in his ways, we'll see the works come to pass. In Jesus' name. God bless all of you. Have a great week. Stay safe going home. We'll see you back here Wednesday or Sunday. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.